The first part of this section, in which I looked at the last ice age and genetic drift, just sets us up for an even bigger goof in paleologic. Lauren Cordain acknowledges it is difficult to say what prehistoric populations ate. So far, so good. That should be enough to undermine his idea for a historic meat-based diet, or at least it should cause him to add a few qualifiers when laying out his one and only ideal human diet. But then he makes a huge mistake. He assumes that somehow hunter-gatherers are good representatives for all the rest of us. Their dietary practices, regardless of plant-to-animal ratios, are so diverse it would seem one would not even be tempted to force them into a single template. But that's exactly what paleologic does. They are all essentially the same as each other, and we are essentially the same as all of them. Here you can see that as of December 2010, Lauren Cordain was still publishing papers built on this premise, which as you see is itself built on the faulty premise of stagnant evolution. We can undermine this logic very easily if we look at the big picture. Here you see the locations of the cradles of civilization that took root with the beginnings of agriculture. Here is a similar map showing where agriculture developed first in orange. If you are watching this, chances are you have a genetic legacy originating from one of these places. Now look where hunter-gatherer populations were in 1950. They are not in areas that supported agriculture, and this is not a coincidence. They expanded into marginal lands, and as a consequence, they have remained frozen in time. Paleologic essentially acknowledges these people were left in the Stone Age. Should it be a surprise that they rely on animal foods in marginal lands? Of course not. These places are considered marginal because they have fewer food resources. Look how scattered across the globe they are. They all represent little isolated pockets of genetic drift. To trace back a point in history when they were all together, along with all other human lineages, you would have to go back to our origins in Africa, the birthplace of the naked ape. Here is another map of hunter-gatherers compiled by Frank Marlowe. This is a wonderful paper. Primitive populations heavily rely on animal foods simply because animals provide them the only way to extract enough calories from their marginal lands. This is not lost on Marlowe. He considers them a biased sample, and one that does not represent pre-agricultural societies. Here you see what should be one of the more obvious trends embedded in the hunter-gatherer food patterns. As populations move to more extreme latitudes lacking in vegetation, they are forced to gather less and hunt and fish more. Marlowe offers a further insight into diet and lifestyle for hunter-gatherers here. This pertains to the need for camp relocations to be near food. You can see that the more hunting is done, the more movement is necessary. I suspect cultures and economies would be less able to develop in nomadic populations. Fishing is more like plant foods in this regard, as it seems to promote sedentism, which is not surprising. Optimal foraging theory states that hunter-gatherers will direct their time and effort to maximize food acquisition. This drives populations toward hunting if calories cannot be obtained in an easier way from plants. It also surely dictates the need to move frequently for nomadic hunters. Knowing now that hunter-gatherers are characterized by relative isolation and marginal ecological niches, it should not be surprising that, to the degree our genes do differ, they tend to set us apart from these cultures. Anyone trying to make an argument for starches not being in compliance with the genome would need to explain why we have adaptations that favor the digestion of starch. Here you see copy number variations in the human genome for genes related to starch digestion. Notice that groups with lower copy numbers for a starch-related gene are hunter-gatherers, while European Americans tend to have more. In contrast, cold weather populations demonstrate a deficiency in enzymes for digesting carbohydrate. There are many examples of unique polymorphisms in hunter-gatherer populations. Here you see that Inuits, who I will discuss at length in another section, have one that raises their cholesterol. In spite of their elevated cholesterol, Inuit may have a loss of a functional mutation related to fat metabolism that protects them from heart disease. This study also finds polymorphisms among the Inuit that are associated with heart disease. These may be signs of genetic drift. Inuit have been shown to have a high resting metabolic rate. an adaptation like this makes sense for people inhabiting cold climates. But this is an adaptation you may not want. Unlike the Inuit, here is a cold-weather hunter-gatherer population that has a mutation that lowers their cholesterol. Lauren Cordain seems unaware of the importance of the genetic differences in isolated populations. Here he mentions the example of the Aceh as supportive of very high-protein diets. The Aceh are some of the least genetically diverse people in the world. Perhaps, along with their high meat consumption, he could also point out their low testosterone levels. The example above does not raise confidence in Cordain's conclusions either. Spelling Arnhem Land wrong is a bad sign for Dr. Cordain. The natives of Arnhem Land have been genetically isolated for almost 20,000 years. Australian Aboriginals themselves are an isolated population, and are therefore more subject to genetic drift. And the natives of Arnhem Land are among the most genetically differentiated of Aboriginals. The paleo crowd is so fixated on primitives, I wonder why they won't go all the way in copying their lifestyles. In the next video, I'll show them how to do that if they want to try real paleo.